I'm going to install a coupler on the A end of the car, as I chose to use the B end of the car to install the Freddy, just to make it a little bit more visually interesting. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take the opportunity to discuss a little bit about couplers and my choice of couplers and what I'm going to do. So I'm just going to start at the very beginning. I'm 54, almost 55 years old. Ever since I was a teenager and discovered that there was metal knuckle couplers, KD has been the deal, the leader in the metal or the actual knuckle coupler industry. They've been around forever. They had patent after patent after patent, and they ran them as long as they could till they finally expired. And now there's other companies out there making couplers. I think the most popular one right now is the McHenry coupler, is the plastic coupler, knuckle coupler of somebody that can compete with KD now. But for anyone who's a young modeler now, you see these things in the kit and you're like, what in the heck is this? Well, this is the NMRA standard coupler. Still to this day, they haven't changed to the knuckle coupler being the standard coupler. This thing is designated X2F, and I don't know where they came up with those numbers. Maybe somebody else will know why they call it X2F. Everybody in the modeling world calls it a horn hook coupler, at least the guys my age. So you younger guys, you probably see these in the kits and go, what in the heck is that? Why do they put that in a kit? It doesn't look like anything I'd ever want to put on my model. And you're right, I throw them in the trash now. So get with it, NMRA. Upgrade to the standard knuckle coupler as your NMRA coupler. Anyway, what's going on in the industry is that KD made a coupler that's got the design on the end here to fit a little phosphor bronze spring plate, so that when you mount these two together, the coupler actually lays in the bronze, phosphor bronze spring plate and centers itself when you install it in the coupler pocket. These work really great. Good idea for many, many years for those of us that wanted to have realistic looking knuckle couplers on our cars. Like I said, when I was about 14 years old, I started buying KD. At the time they were called 5 and 10. I don't know why. And then they were called the number 5 coupler, and now they've gone to a whisker deal. I'd like to talk about the whisker deal a little bit. I'm not sure. I'm just making educated guesses here. But as I said, that Walthers has invented this nifty thing called the swing pocket coupler deal. And you'll notice that it has these little extensions on the end. Well, when the patent ran out on the KD couplers and other companies were starting to copy them, McHenry, along with probably a few others, and I'm not sure exactly brand names right now, but they started putting those same type of centering whiskers on the end of their coupler pocket. Again, that matches the Walthers design that was on their swing coupler pockets for many years. And the cool thing that's come about that now is that KD has finally dropped the phosphor bronze centering spring, and they're starting to equip, and these are very thin and very fine. I don't know if you can see it that well, but you know, you've probably bought one at the hobby shop, and for those of you that haven't, they're out there. But you know, like I'm saying, the younger modelers now, that's all you see. It's kind of like cell phones, and we used to have dial rotary phones in our homes, and nobody that's young has probably really ever seen one except for on TV. I don't know if there's, you know, maybe you go to the museum or somebody, some old fart's house, and you see they've still got their old rotary phone because they haven't joined the real world yet. But anyway, now KD has these centering springs on their couplers as well. So that's a few cool things that have happened with the coupler in the industry over the past several years, and we're all benefiting from technology. So it's kind of cool that or the patent ran out on the KD, and other people were able to bring new ideas into the industry, and it's become quite a boon for us modelers as we get the benefits of all the companies battling for technology and trying to get your dollar out of your pocket. So I still have a few of the old style couplers left over, and with the phosphor centering spring, phosphor bronze. And if you look at the phosphor spring itself, it has like the spring on the side, and then where it goes back into the solid part of the coupler, why it has these little bumps on it, what I'm getting around to. I seem to ramble on quite a bit, so sorry about that. But anyway, those bumps, they did cause problems in that some of the coupler pockets in the industry weren't big enough to accept the raised area up there that's too high. So I spend a lot of time installing these things and taking a file and filing them down flush so that they were as high as the spring, and the same on the back, that you can see there that I filed that down so that it'll fit nicely into a coupler pocket without creating any drag. Now if you put the two side by side and look, you can see how much I filed off, quite a bit. And the same with the front tabs, that I have filed off quite a bit of that front tab so that they'll fit into the coupler pocket nicely. So now that I've got that out of the way, I'm going to tell you that my choice of coupler for my 89-foot flat cars is the longer shank coupler that I have here. I use these because when the trailer hitch landing gear is mounted on the flat car, it allows the 45-foot trailers to go back-to-back. And to do that, in the real world, they had to move the trailer hitch out closer to the end of the car, so the trailer actually overhangs the end of the car. Now, in our modeling world, by doing that and trying to negotiate the tight radius curves we have, you can have problems with the corners of the trailers actually hitting each other when you go into the curve. They go into the curve and they bang into each other. So I use the longer shank coupler to actually space the cars apart a little bit farther. In the real world, there's a big cushion draft gear, what they call draft gear. There's a lot of springs and a lot of heavy equipment up in there. And if you've ever watched a train go down the track while they're pulling, you'll see these couplers, they look like they're stretched way out, and then when they're braking, you'll see and it looks like the coupler's shoved way in. Well, I use the long one so that the corner of the trailers don't hit, but so that it'll actually represent a car that's under a little bit of a load. So that's my excuse and that's my story, and of course, as the saying goes, I'm sticking to it. So what I do with these couplers now is, you may have heard me mention earlier that I cut the trip pins off. What I mean by that is, if you notice that these things, the KD designed this metal trip pin, and it kind of does two things. It kind of represents the air hose connection between the cars, and it also works with a magnet under the track, of course, to release the knuckle open so that you can have automatic uncoupling from your car. Now, it's my preference. I like to take this trip pin and I like to nip it off flush with the face of the coupler, because I found that I do most of my coupling and uncoupling by hand, like they do in the real world anyway. They don't have magnets under the tracks in the real world, and so therefore I notice that when I trim these off and the cars are next to each other, it actually looks like the air hoses are touching instead of overlapping. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, but the trip pins will overlap some, that you can actually see it from the side that they go by each other. So I've opted to, on my models, is what I'll do is I'll take my metal nippers here, and I've used them a lot. You can see all the gouges in them that from cutting these things. What I do is I get the flush side of the nipper up against the face of the coupler, and I'll actually Now, let me see if I can turn it this way so you can actually see it a little better. I'll get that right up to the flush there, straight up and down, and then I'll go ahead and chop that baby off. So here we go. Okay, also a good idea to point it away from you and or wear safety glasses, because sometimes that piece goes flying like it did this time. And now, if you'll notice, that trip pin is flush with the face of the coupler. And it's also got a little bit of cut mark on the end, so that kind of represents the metal glad hand, what they call the glad hand on the end of the air hose. They call it a glad hand because it's kind of like shaking hands when you lock them together and they lock together. So I don't know, it's a railroad term, glad hand. So that's where it came from. So what I do is, whoops, I didn't get this prepared, but after I cut that off, I have a little trick I use, and that's that I take black paint and I paint the spring in the side of the coupler, because that does two things. Number one, first and foremost, it hides that spring. A lot of people will run their trains with just the spring like that, and you can see it, and that bothers me. So what I do is I take my black paint and, oops, I'm going to have to grab my channel locks again, get this thing open. I take my black paint and I paint that coupler spring. So I've got my black paint on the end. I've got my bronze spring. Just hoping to get a good view on this. Anyway, I'll just go ahead and take the black paint and just start painting the spring. It holds paint, actually. And actually, I said it does two things. Number one, it hides the spring. You don't see it. And number two, after it dries, and I don't know if any of you have ever experienced this or not, but sometimes in a derailment or if you get the coupler run by on the wrong side, it knocks that spring loose and boing, they go flying off into the air. Next thing you know, you don't have a spring in there, and they're kind of a pain in the butt to put them back in. So what I've done there now, maybe you can see it, maybe you can't. It doesn't probably want to focus that good on there. I've painted that spring and it's all but disappeared. You can't really see it on there anymore like you can on one that hasn't been painted. Let me see if I can get the two of them side by side there so you can see. Yeah, see, the one with the, here's the one with the spring in it that hasn't been painted. Here's the one with the spring that has been painted. You can't even really see it on there. And then while I'm at it, I go ahead and, because that trip pin is shiny, the air hoses in the real world aren't shiny, I'll just go ahead and put some paint down that thing all around it, and that kind of hides the shine off of the trip pin. Now I'll go ahead and leave that end where I chopped it off, I'll go ahead and leave the bare metal there, so it kind of again represents the glad hand. So when the two trip pins, actually I've got another one that I've already chopped and pre-painted. So now, when the two trip pins are next to each other, you can kind of see the silver tips there. And when they're coupled together, they kind of match up pretty good. So it looks like, from the side, it almost looks like their air hoses are connected, instead of having the big run-by with the other one, with the uncut ones. So that's what I do with these couplers. I'm going to install the coupler in the swing pocket, that I showed in the little talk about the coupler. And one thing I was going to mention in the coupler deal that I didn't is, when you're building a long runner car, which is actually 289-foot decks connected by a solid drawbar, Walthers provides this plastic drawbar thinger here. A lot of guys have tried these and they've broken and they get frustrated with them. So what they do is they wind up just putting the coupler on both cars. And a lot of well cars are drawbar connected. At least they were in the 90s. I think they've got away from that now because it was kind of a pain in the butt that when you had a problem with one car, you had to pull all the well cars that were in that connected unit out of service. So I think they've pretty much got away from that. But what I'm getting at here is I work in a metal shop and I have the ability to do a little bit of programming. And what I've done is I've taken a KD coupler into work and I spec'd it out. If you look, you can kind of see what I did here. I copied that, and what I did is I just made a metal drawbar out of 16 gauge carbon steel, cold rolled steel they call it, and that actually replaces this one so that now I have a steel one to use instead, and it doesn't break. I have a car that I've done with that drawbar and it's pretty dang solid. So when you're doing the long runner connected car, I substitute this. And you know what, I've made a whole bunch of them. I'd be happy to sell you one if you want to try one out. I'd just ask you a dollar for it because I had to pay for these at work to have them made. They don't give me a lot of freebies around there. So if you want one, send me a message or something, a personal message, and say, hey, I'd like to try one of those out. Send me a buck or something, and I'll mail one to you. You can try it out, and then if you like them, then maybe you can buy some more of them off me or something. So what we do now is we get the long runner, or not the long runner, we just get the swing coupler pocket. We place that in the car over the posts, over the appropriate posts. You want to make sure that you get the whisker deals inside those posts right there. So that's what creates the extra swivel, or swivel, extra side-to-side motion that you get. Then you drop your phosphor bronze spring in there. Now, if I had a whisker coupler, that you don't use the phosphor bronze spring anymore for those. But like I said, I have a few of the longer ones left over. You just go ahead and put your coupler inside of the phosphor bronze plate and hold that in place with your finger. You take the cover. I've got my hands backwards here, so let me trade left hand, right hand, and you just kind of slide that over the top, in underneath. Oops, it locks in place there. That fits in under these here. That's why those tangs are on there, so the coupler pocket fits in underneath them. You don't have to glue these. They'll hold theirself in there. You might have a little bit of slop in there. If you do and you don't like the slop, you can always take a little 1/10 shim or something and put it underneath there so you don't have any of the slop in. This is going to be the last car on my train, so I'm not worried about the slop because it only affects your car when you get a lot of pull tension on it, and it tends to want to wander the drawbar up or down, and then you have what's called a slip by, which is what happens when you're pulling your car and you go over a bump in the track or something, and the drawbar slips by, and then they come uncoupled all the time. But since this is the last car on the train, I'm not going to worry about that. Anyway, you just go ahead and you put your screw in. Now I've knocked the screws all over the place. You go ahead and you just put your screw in there and tighten it down, and the coupler is now mounted to your car. So I'm waiting for the paint to dry on the truck, so that'll coming a little bit. Okay, I went to turn the screw down and it was too long, so what I've done is I've taken my metal nippers, and this is a soft brass screw, so it's pretty easy. You just chop a little bit of it off of there, file it down so it's nice and flat again on the end, and fix the threads because you kind of squish them when you do that. And like I said, I'm going to take just a little bit of Elmer's glue and put it on the end of the screw. Whoops, I blobbed it. That's okay. I have plenty of paper towels around. anyway, you get a little bit of Elmer's glue there on the end of the screw, so it fills the threads up a little bit. And we'll go ahead and we'll pop that in there and screw it down. And now our coupler and coupler pocket are mounted on the A end of the car. And again, like I said, I strip those threads out so I get it down there where it goes. I hold it into place. And it's nice and flat now, and that Elmer's that I squirted on the end, why, that'll set up, and the next thing you know, you'll never even notice it was there. You have a good good screw.